This is the way the early sea explorers came into the Pacific, around the southwest coast of Tasmania. First of these was the Dutchman, Abel Tasman. Then 100 years later came men like James Cook and Captain Bligh. By the time they'd reached here, they'd come halfway around the world. They'd run the gauntlet of the roaring 40s. They were really looking for somewhere safe to land. And here, at Adventure Bay, on Bruny Island, that's exactly what they found, a safe anchorage. This is a very historic beach. More of the great explorers of the 19th century walked on this beach than any other part of Australia. This was the first contact that they made with the land and with the bush, and especially the original Tasmanian people. And yet, less than 50 kilometres away from here, the country is as wild as it was then, 200 years ago, when they landed here. Some of it hasn't even been explored, even today. Tasmania's west is a challenging country. People have always needed a special reason to go into it at all. On this journey, we're going to see what took people into the West and what they found. Now, from here at Adventure Bay, we'll fly around the west coast to Strawn, and we'll make our base there. And finally, I'm going to head north to a place I call Tasmania's Ayers Rock. Captain Cook wasn't the first person to land on this beach, Adventure Bay. But on this very beach was his first contact with Australian Aborigines. And what I'm trying to do here today is paint that scene, what would have happened that day. That meeting took place on the 26th of January, 1777, which was later to become known as Australia Day. Of course, Australia wasn't settled until 11 years later. Now, to me, Cook was an extraordinary man, not because of his great sea voyages, but because of his, say, perception, because he knew that a lot of his discoveries would have a devastating effect on these Aborigines. This day was going to mark the start of the complete annihilation of a tribe of people. And it only took something like 100 years, and there was not an Aborigine left on Tasmania. When Captain Cook came here, one of his officers was William Bligh. Now, Bligh later came back in command of his own ship, the Bounty. When we hear the name Captain Bligh, we naturally think of mutiny on the Bounty. But there was another side to him that very few of us knew about. Most of these sea captains, as they sailed around the world, they brought their seeds from Europe with them, simply to see how the crops of Europe would grow in these strange lands. And Captain Bligh, when he came here, he planted apple trees. Now, after he'd got over his troubles with mutiny on the Bounty, he came back here. And lo and behold, the apples had grown. There was trees here. Now, this is not the original tree, but it was grafted off Bligh's original tree. And this started one of the great success stories of Tasmania.
Thank you.
with names like Red Delicious, Democrats, Granny Smiths, up to 20 different varieties are grown for the domestic market, as well as being exported worldwide from Tasmania, which is indeed the Apple Isle. How you going there, Jimmy? You got one for me yet?
Yeah, it's
right. Oh, beauty. Tell you what, I love these apples.
Yeah, it's amazing they're still so well, you know.
Beautiful. What would be the biggest one?
Hazel Brothers.
No, Jim Higgins runs the general store, so he knows this area very, very well. I wonder how many people camping here would realise that the holes behind their tents are the remains of 200-year-old saw pits where Bligh cut timbers and planks for his ships.
Well, one man, this was a lot deeper, of course. You had one man down in it with a cross-cut saw, one man on the top and a makeshift table, and the two of them just worked a cross-cut saw. And
what a bit of one pushing and one pulling.
One pushing and one pulling, yeah.
That's amazing.
And they cut really big timbers that way, too.
Yeah.
Really big timbers.
Now, when they cut these planks, like, you know, they're on shore in the boats out there, what do they do now?
Well, then they attach their blocks up in the big gums.
Right.
They run their ropes out, and they actually attach them to the boat, and they just use a pulley to pull their timbers
just literally straight haul them out.
Haul them straight out,
yeah.
And do the repairs on board.
Botanists who came here found the natural bush very interesting. In fact, just the same as Bligh found his apple trees. Here they found plants and trees that were unknown anywhere else in the world. It is said that the first new scientific identification of a new family of trees was made right here at Two Tree Point. Now, this was a very extraordinary family of trees known as eucalypts. Of course, today we refer to them as gum trees. The early explorers, they didn't come here just by accident. They knew that they could find the things they needed here. Fresh water, fresh meat, and especially timber for spars and masts to repair their ships. Now this search took them deep into the west, and they were looking for a special tree. This tree was perfect for shipbuilding. But it was so rare that it was only found deep in the rainforests of Western Tasmania. Now, I'm going to follow the route that they took. Aha! Here's my bus now. The special tree that they were looking for was the Huon pine. Now, the search was led by a man from Bruny Island, and his name was James Kelly. Heading southwest, it doesn't take long for the farms to give away to the wilderness. Kelly sailed around South Cape. He saw the sheer cliffs of Precipitous Bluff, the southernmost and to me the most spectacular of the dolerite peaks that run like a backbone through central Tasmania. These peaks were formed by molten rock forced up from the Earth's core as the continents were splitting away. Once they lay under a huge plateau of sandstone, but it wore away, leaving these knife blade peaks exposed.
glaciers carved out the valleys and gouged out the lakes in the last ice age, no more than 20,000 years ago. And Aborigines would have watched and heard all this happen. Back in the ice age, these were mountaintops. Now they're islands called the Matsikas, surrounded by their treacherous reefs. Kelly threaded his way through here, sticking very close to the coast. He rounded the southwest cape. Now he was heading north, at the risk of the sea and the winds that tried to push him into the shore. But he pressed on and found what he was looking for, a safe harbour. He called this harbour Port Davey. This is the very heart of the southwest wilderness. Now we're landing here because there's a couple of very special things I want to show you. Firstly, I would like you to meet a real pioneer of this remote place. Meet Denny King. He's the only permanent resident here. He's lived alone in this area for the last 40 years. And one of his jobs, as with most Tasmanians, is keeping an eye on the weather. But his is a very important eye, for this is the only reliable weather report for the southwest corner of Tasmania. And it's also Denny's only contact with the outside world.
I said yes to Hobart, I said yes to Hobart, good morning, standing by with the figures.
Go ahead, Denny.
Going ahead. 11496.
Another interesting point also deals with the weather. The vegetation here is all native plants, and one of the real surprises of this country is that although it looks very fertile, none of it will grow crops. And that's the main reason southwest Tasmania is still a wilderness. This place is an amazing place. It's full of surprises everywhere you go. Now, we all know that Australia is the driest continent in the world. But this southwestern Tasmania is one of the wettest. They get something like 3 metres of rain a year. Like, that is 10 feet. And yet, with all that rain, their biggest worry down in this area is bushfires. And this stuff, this button grass around here, can turn into a raging inferno just a few hours after being saturated with rain. When Kelly came here, he noticed small bands of Aborigines all along the coast, and one of the things he saw them using was fire to open up the country, and often they used it to hunt the game out of the forest. But by burning this country for thousands of years, they also changed the ecology of the country. Kelly left Port Davey and headed north. Because of the treacherous coastline, he chose the safety of a small rowing boat. Little did he know that his greatest discovery was yet to come. Kelly had good reason for using a rowboat, because the big seas and howling winds of the roaring 40s drive onto this coast all the year round. Now, it's the kind of situation that sailors dread, and it's what kept Tasman and Cook well offshore. In the rowing boat, Kelly didn't have that problem. They stuck to the coast throughout the day, then camped ashore at night. Something unusual happened here many years ago. In fact, it was Christmas Day. They had just found a new cove, and they'd called it Christmas Cove. Now, the West Coasters tell me this had never happened before, nor will ever happen again. They poured a glass of brandy to celebrate, but instead of drinking it, they poured it into the bay. Now, to them, this was sacrilege, a waste of good liquor. Eventually, Kelly and his party rounded Cape Sorrel. Ahead of them, they could see 50 kilometres of surf beach. But they also saw an inlet. They thought they'd discovered a new river. They could see water rushing out. But little did they realise that they were to become the very first Europeans to pass through Hell's Gates. Even today, Hell's Gates is a treacherous entrance. But beyond Hell's Gates lay what every sailor on the west coast was looking for, a huge stretch of deep sheltered water, much bigger than Sydney Harbour, and Kelly named it Macquarie Harbour. And beyond Hell's Gates lay what Kelly was really looking for, the precious timber, the Huon pine. This is the port of Strawn, situated at the head of Macquarie Harbour. Now it's from here that the tourists set out to follow in Kelly's footsteps. On the upper reaches of the harbour, Kelly found stands of Huon pine growing right down to the water's edge. He also found the mouth of a great river. Now he followed this river upstream. More pines grew along its bank, and he named this river after the man who had loaned him the boat for the expedition, the Gordon River. Ever since, this river has been the pathway to the wilderness for tourists and timber cutters alike. Today, it's hard to find any Huon pine within reach of the river. And to get any idea of what these great stands of timber look like, we have to go into the heart of the wilderness. Into country that can only be reached by bushwalkers. This is the last big stand of the ancient Huon pine in Tasmania. These are remarkable trees. To start with, they're one of Australia's very few native softwoods. But unlike most softwoods, they do not grow quickly. Some have been dated over 3,000 years. They grow very slowly, and for this reason, the grain is very tight. They grow very tall and straight. They provide a very useful timber. They're softwood, so that makes them very easy to work. These trees contain a natural resin called dacrodil. It does two things. It repels insects and it repels water. And what that adds up to, particularly in timber so light, is that it floats. It is a perfect wood for shipbuilding. And that's what gave Huon pine its value and brought men like Kelly searching for it. These trees largely owe their survival to one man who fought not just to save these trees, but to save much of the southwest from destruction and exploitation. And his name was Allagus Trehanus. Trehanus made no less than 30 journeys into the wilderness. He travelled alone. And where no European had ever been before, he took photos to show people what he was trying to save. He was the first person ever to canoe down the full length of the Gordon River, but tragically, in 1972, the Gordon took his life. But these trees he fought to save are now protected, and they in turn preserve his name. This is now called Trehanus Reserve, and you can still only get there after a 30-kilometre bushwalk. Back in the early days, Kelly settled here and logged the Huon Pine. Now, the government of the day also saw another use for this settlement because of its isolation. It was an ideal location for a penal settlement. The prison was set up on a tiny island in the middle of Macquarie Harbour, and that's where we're going next. From a distance, Sarah Island today looks as wild as it did before anyone came here. But enough remains to get some idea of what this place looked like as a penal settlement. The first party came ashore in 1821. Now, eight of the prisoners were women. They put them out there on Grummet Island, probably for their own safety. But they didn't send women here for long. Grummet became the ultimate punishment for prisoners who couldn't be controlled, even on Sarah. There was no way ashore except by wading from the boats. Prisoners on Grummet slept soaking wet all the year round. The work here was timber cutting and boat building, but the real purpose was punishment and terror. The punishment of these prisoners was so harsh that it spread terror throughout the convict colony, the terror of being sent here. And after 150 years, as I walk around this island today, there is plenty of evidence of those harsh times. Most people know that thousands of Australia's first settlers were convicted prisoners sent from England. But what they don't know, that more than half of these were sent to Tasmania. The whole of Tasmania was an open prison. So this place was a prison within a prison, the ultimate punishment station. But only the worst, the most hardened prisoners were ever sent here. This is all that's left of the oven in the officers' quarters. Now, really, the main routine here was work. And they worked every day, from daylight till dark, in appalling conditions. Because of the high rainfall here, it could be teeming with rain weeks on end. So they would work all day under these conditions and then have to sleep and never dry out. And because of the isolation of this place, it caused two problems. One was that the guards were here all the time with the prisoners. They couldn't get off either. And also, the boats bringing supplies, because of weather, couldn't get through Hell's Gates. So they'd be hungry, to make things worse. The treatment of the prisoners was so brutal that on an average there was 300 people here. And in 1 year, 160 of these people received 34,000 lashes. Now, that is unbelievable. The guards were literally trying to thrash them into submission because they were terrified of them. They knew that those prisoners got out of their chains, they would murder them. And this they did because the prisoners would literally do anything to get this place. So when they got the opportunity, they would murder the guard. And then as they took them away on the boat, to Hobart, to the gallows, they were laughing all the way. They would have done anything to get off this place. The coast wasn't far away. A lot of the time, the prisoners were working ashore, and there was no less than 112 escapes in 10 years. They disappeared into the wilderness with no way through. More than half of them were never seen again. They would have starved to death, making a bid for freedom.
One very gruesome story I'd like to tell you was about an Alexander Pierce. He escaped from here with seven prisoners, and it wasn't long they were starving, so they decided to kill a prisoner, and they kept doing this till eventually Pierce was the only one left. The authorities eventually caught up with him and brought him back here to Sarah Island, and it wasn't long, just a few months, and he escaped again, taking with him a food supply, another prisoner. And of course, the moment he got hungry, he killed him and ate him. But when they caught up with him the second time, they didn't bring him back here. They took him to Hobart and he was hung. If for a moment I forget all the terrible things that happened on this island, there was some good things too. And one of them was by a prisoner by the name of William Gould. Now, he was an artist, and he was a magnificent artist. He loved to paint the wildlife, the flowers, the birds, the fish. And I could easily imagine him coming down to, say, a place like this and immersing himself in just doing a painting. For one thing, it would help him to remain sane. You can still see Huon pines washed up here, as sound as the day the convicts cut them 150 years ago. And traces of the old Huon pine slipways. They came here to build boats. In fact, they built over 70 of them. And one of those boats figured in the last and most remarkable of all escape stories on Sarah Island. Most of the terrible things that happened on this island have been well and truly documented over the years. In fact, I found a very interesting book, The Men That God Forgot. And this is a story about here. In fact, it's a story about a ship called the Frederick. Now, a group of prisoners, when they'd finished making this ship, decided that they would steal it. So they overpowered their guards, put them on board, and stole the ship and sailed away. Now, they only went, firstly, over to the mainland, put their guards ashore, and even gave them food. And then they headed east as fast as they could go. And eventually, they reached South America. And there, they remained free for a considerable time. But eventually, they were caught. And they were tried for being mutineers. Now, the judge threw this out of court, because technically, they were not mutineers, because the ship had never been commissioned. It was not one of Her Majesty's ships. Now, that would have been a lovely story to have finished there, but it wasn't, simply because they were prisoners. They had escaped, and they were brought back to serve the rest of their time on Norfolk Island. Only two sawmills in the world still cut Huon pine. Both of them are in Strawn. They don't only mill Huon pine here. There are three other rare pines: King Billy, Celery Top, and of course Mountain Ash. People have been taking timber out of these forests for over 150 years. Now, in the old days, they seemed to have no idea that it would take between 500 and 1,000 years to regrow.
It's different today. There's a new dam site west of here. In a year or two, all these trees will be underwater. These days, hewn pine can only be cut in places like this. Rain made life a nightmare for the early settlers in the west. Just like the convicts, they were wet more often than they were dry. Constant rain turned bush tracks into quagmires.
Tasmanians never run out of something to talk about, and invariably it's the weather. In fact, the locals tell me that if it is not raining here, it's about to start, because they get in excess of 200 days a year of rain. But really, it's one of their treasures, because without the rain, they would never have this, the magnificent forests of Tasmania. And something like 100 years ago, they realised that all this rain was probably their greatest treasure.
Nearly all of Tasmania's electricity needs are met by hydropower, water power. This is the Gordon River Dam. It is one of the biggest engineering projects ever undertaken in Tasmania. In fact, this 1 kilometre long tunnel takes us down to a depth of over 190 metres and to the heart of the hydroelectric plant. The turbines generate up to 25% of the state's electricity needs. Tasmania has what most of the rest of the world is looking for, a perpetual system of power generation that is safe, pollution-free, and uses up none of the world's fossil fuels. And the contradiction in all this is that the activity of the Hydro Authority is what finally brought confrontation into the West. The determined opposition to the hydro plan to build a dam on the Gordon River came as a shock to a lot of people, but it wasn't really so surprising. Since the 1920s, hydro dams have been pushing further and further into the wilderness. Most of the West's wild rivers either have been harnessed for power or will be in the years to come. But by the 1960s, more and more people were starting to value the West, not for the treasure it could produce, but for the treasure it was in itself. And this point of view isn't hard to understand once you've seen this area.
The early explorers found this country practically impossible to penetrate. But when they did get in there, it was a paradise for the botanists, because all these new species of plants. Now, I'm amazed that they ever got through this country. And really, the only way they got through was to follow the rivers along, which led them into the interior.
The Gordon and its tributary, the Franklin, are the greatest of Tasmania's wild rivers. They slice through the very heart of the wilderness. Rafting these rivers takes 2 to 3 weeks and is a major commitment. There's no way back once you've started. Those who make this journey compare it with no other experience in their lifetime. This is where the Franklin River meets the Gordon. It was below here that the dam that caused all the trouble was going to be built. It was people like the rafters who knew what would be lost. These people led the protests. They had already lost one battle over an earlier dam, and they believed they could not let that happen again. As it turned out, hundreds of thousands of Australians also agreed with them. The Battle of the Gordon wasn't fought without conflict and bitterness, but the end result was a victory for the wilderness itself. Today, the Gordon and the Franklin, together with much of the southwest, all the way in fact to Port Davey and Precipitous Bluff, are protected as a World Heritage Area. This part of the wilderness is largely man-made. Lake Gordon and Lake Pedder were enlarged as a direct result of the dam building for the hydroelectric power. Now, I think it's tragic when any part of the natural world is changed, particularly when rare plants and animals might be destroyed. But there are still a couple of points I want to make.
You know, nothing in nature remains static. And for every man-made dam, there are literally hundreds formed by glaciers. Because the Ice Age tore this country apart with more destructive power than man has ever used or ever likely to use. And if the destruction of the wilderness has been tragic, how much more tragic has it been when you think of Three Mile Island and Chernobyl? And while people want power, and that includes the most staunchest wilderness people, there will always have to be a compromise.
I can see both sides of the story, but I think it's completely wrong to paint dam builders as villains. Because what they've done here, in a way, has been a minor miracle. But I can't say that about the next place I'm going to show you.
That would have to be a conservationist's impression of what the end of the world would look like. In fact, it's very hard to find a tree down there.
The appearance of this landscape is caused by man's interference with nature. You could say it looked dreadful. On the other hand, I've seen landscapes similar to this in the outback that are completely natural and people say they look beautiful. But you have to admit, it looks striking. A complete contrast to the rest of the West. And really, that's why the visitors come to see it. But those bare hills were not the reason that people came here in the first place. They came here because Queenstown is a mining town. And here was made one of the richest strikes in the world. For a few years, around the turn of the century, Queenstown was quoted on every stock exchange in the world. And that was because of one man. His name was Bose Kelly. He was already a mining millionaire when he arrived from Broken Hill. And the locals sold him what they thought was an unprofitable gold mine. But Kelly wasn't after gold. They had sold him what turned out to be the world's richest copper mine. Smelters were built to refine the copper. Railways were built to take the refined copper to Strawn. Tasmania was in a depression. Imagine the effect when the mines advertised for 300 axemen to clear a path for the line. Queenstown's copper mines were the richest in the Southern Hemisphere. Round the turn of the century, they were spending more. They were earning more than the whole of the Tasmanian government. Queenstown was Tasmania's third largest town. A whole network of railways had to be built to carry the wealth of the West to the coast. This is the only train still running. It still follows the old prospectors' trails. Until the 1930s, trains like these were the West's only land link with the outside world. There are road links now, and most of the little trains have long since gone. They still mine copper here today, but it is deep underground. In 1903, they said that Queenstown Field had only a couple more years to go. In fact, they still mine it 100 years after Kelly bought the original mine. It makes me think, if we jump back, say, 100 odd years ago when this mine was going to be set up, and if, say, there was greenies and wilderness people then that do these protests, and they were told that they were going to set up a mine here, they were going to have a treatment plant, and the end result was going to be this. It would have never got off the ground. Today, when I come here, I'm fascinated with it. Since the treatment plant closed, the trees have started to grow back. Now, this is worrying the locals, simply because if they keep growing, it'll be the same as the rest of Tasmania. Gone will be all this difference that the tourists come here to see. Queenstown's boom helped to open up the whole of the West, including the high alpine country, and that's where we're going on the last leg of this journey. The only way through from Lake St Clair to Cradle Mountain is by walking. Like the Gordon River, this is a track that calls for commitment and brings rewards to match. And to me, the greatest of all those rewards comes right at the end of the track, at the northern entrance to Tasmania's west, Cradle Mountain. For walkers who have spent 3 days coming across country, Cradle Mountain Lodge comes as a very welcome sight at the end of the track.
She's got to go right, eh?
Partly because of the friendly atmosphere, partly because it's usually the first chance in days to get really warm. But the very special things that happen here, I suppose you could call it a floor show, doesn't happen until after dinner. But before that, there are a couple of things I want to show you. This is Waldheim. It was built in 1912 by a man called Gustav Weindorfer. At that time, there was no roads in here, nor was there any national parks. And all these buildings he built by hand. Weindorfer devoted his life to doing two things. Firstly, to making the wonders of this area known to other bushwalkers. The second was to campaign to have Cradle Mountain declared a national park. He succeeded in both. So Gustav Weindorfer rests here, a half a world away from the Austria where he was born, but very close to the Cradle Mountain that he did so much to preserve. And the new lodge here also preserves one of his customs. Every night, after dark, is feeding time for the animals of the West. Most of Australia's native animals are nocturnal. Some of these animals are unique to Tasmania. The native cat, timid looking, is in fact ferocious. The Tasmanian devil, the villain of the piece, looking very ferocious, in fact, is quite timid. This whole performance recreates a nightly ritual in Weindorfer's lodge. This is what he wrote in his diary. When the ground is covered with snow, I do build a big fire. I open my door, seat myself very, very quietly, and presently they come in, one by one, the wild animals, without the usual fear of man or of one another. I do like those words, and I do like that painting. It's not one of mine. It's a mural in the town of Sheffield. But I do have a painting to paint. I'm going to try and capture the mood of Cradle Mountain.
You remember when I started this program, I told you that I would show you Tasmania's Ayers Rock, and here it is, Cradle Mountain, magnificent. And what I'm trying to do here is try and capture some of the mood, some of the feeling of this place. Now on this trip I've told you many stories, but to me there is two that stand out more than the rest. First was Trehanus and his discoveries of the river systems of the southwest wilderness. Secondly, was Weindorfer, of his discoveries of the northern part and Cradle Mountain. And like Tasman and Cook, they had come halfway around the world to a strange new land to make these discoveries and made us aware of the importance of this country. And when I think of all this, that is really what travel's all about, isn't it? Anyway, it's been nice being with you. I've got some work to do now. I've got to try and finish this. See you next time.